Good morning, and welcome to another edition of The Road 2. I'm Patti Morrissey, your hostess. We have a really special day today. We have the three lieutenant governor candidates on the Democratic side for lieutenant governor of Virginia and running this year. We'll get to them in just one second, but we're going to introduce our one pundit today, Mike Lane.
Patti, it's actually a thrill to be on the set today. Normally, you know, we have a slightly different format for this show. Our regular viewers will remember me as the inside the Beltway guy and one of the rotating conservatives. But today, I'm elated to share the stage with the three prominent Democratic candidates for lieutenant governor of the Commonwealth of Virginia. I'm just going to let it go at that, and we'll listen to them.
We'll let you poke them a little bit. Yeah, we need someone doing that. All right, we're going to start with Gene Rossi, one of our three candidates. Do you want to tell us a little bit about yourself?
Well, I am a lifelong Democrat, born and raised, and I have a passion for protecting people, and I'm a fighter. And a lot of that passion and fight came from what I did for the last 27 years. I was a person who stood in federal court, and I spoke for those who could not speak for themselves. Victims alive and dead, the afraid, the ignored, and forgotten. And during two of my 110 federal trials, I had the honor to sit to the left of Justin Fairfax. And I want to take that passion and that fight and focus on health care, public education, small businesses, and criminal justice reform.
Okay, great. Very focused. We'll go to Justin next, since you were.
Yes,
absolutely.
Absolutely. Well, first of all, thank you so much, Patti, and good morning to you and to Mike and to Susan and to Gene. We're excited to be with you. And I am also a former federal prosecutor. I was at the U.S. Attorney's Office in the Eastern District of Virginia in the Major Crimes and Narcotics Unit. I'm now a practicing attorney, a litigator at the Venable Law Firm. Here in Tyson's Corner. My wife, Dr. Serena Fairfax, is a dentist. We're small business owners. We own a family dental practice that's actually just up the road from here that we bought 10 years ago. I have two young children, a 7-year-old son and a soon-to-be 6-year-old daughter. And I am someone who is focused on creating more economic security and opportunity for all Virginians. I want more folks to be able to get higher paying middle skilled jobs to reduce the burden of crushing student loan debt and also to make sure that more people can access capital to start and grow their own small businesses, and that we defend people's constitutional rights and reform our criminal justice system. So those are the things that I'm passionate about. As you know, I ran 4 years ago for Attorney General of the Commonwealth of Virginia. I won nearly 49% of the statewide vote and the Washington Post endorsement in that race. And I've been tremendously active over the last 4 years, helping to elect Senator Mark Warner to the Senate. Also, I was a surrogate for the Clinton Cain campaign last year. So I've traveled now over 35,000 miles around Virginia, fighting for progressive causes, and look forward to a great race here on June the 13th.
Good way to get to know it.
Thank you.
And last but not least, Susan Platt.
Patti, thank you very much, and to all my other fellow candidates here with me this morning. I never thought I'd be running for office in any place. I have been an advocate and an activist in Virginia for Virginia jobs and Virginia Democratic principles and policies, progressive policies in the Commonwealth for nearly 30 years. I've worked for Chuck Robb as his campaign manager against Oliver North. You may remember that race. I've been Joe Biden's chief of staff in the United States Senate, where I had the honor, where we lived our love of family every day, which we learned from him. And it's all about putting food on the table, a roof over the head, and making sure that those that we bring up, our families, have better opportunities than we did. My pops was one of 13 children coming from an immigrant family from Czechoslovakia. His father worked in the steel mills of Pittsburgh. They lived in a two-room house. And he was the only one that went to college on the GI Bill, and he taught dance at Arthur Murray, and I never got the gene, unfortunately. But he and my mom, when they danced, it was magic. She was diagnosed with breast cancer when I was 5, and she passed when I was 9. So I'm here because of my pops. And I tell all men across the Commonwealth, because you empower us, we can be the best we can. And he told me that I should never be defined by my gender or anything else, because he made it up. He thought we all should have the same opportunities. So as a woman, I felt that I could do anything I wanted to do. And as a result, I paid it forward over the last 10 years in Virginia by Mary Sue Terry and I founding the Farm Team, which was a group organized to help women run for office, as you very well know. And then we folded it into something called Emerge Virginia. And over the course of those last 8 years, I have helped train over 300 women to run for office. And we've elected quite a few, which I'm very proud of. But in the last 2 years, I haven't been as active. That's because my pops passed away of Alzheimer's dementia, which is something we all deal with. But my stepdaughter, for the last, my stepdaughter Karen, passed away due to addiction. We had been supporting her and our two grandchildren for close to 15 years now. Because she couldn't. And my granddaughter once heard me on the phone talking to my husband about needing to change the tires on my car during this period. And I got off the phone and she looked at me and she said, "Grandma Susu, as a feminist, you should be changing your own tires." And I looked at her and I said, "Kristen, it's because I'm a feminist, I have a choice. And I choose not to do that." And that's why I'm running, is that I believe we all should have choices to live the best life that we can. And I'll be a children's advocate 100% all the way from birth through college. And because Governor Kane appointed me to the Tourism Corporation Board, I believe we need to help expand all opportunities because tourism is a major economic driver in the state.
Okay, thank you, Susan. We'll get back to, at the end of the show, you know, a little bit more consolidation of like your core platform issues. But we wanted to just have a little warm-up conversation, given that this is the Democratic crew. A little critique of the first 100 days of the Trump administration. And why don't we just kind of focus on the issues, like two issues that you think emerged that should be, or you'd like to contrast yourself with. And if Mike would like to jump in and kind of, you know, maybe give a little bit of the other side of that, because I don't want you just to be sitting here. Okay, let's start with you.
To quote Brendan Sullivan, what do you think I am, a potted plant?
So we'll start with Gene.
So
and,
you want me to give a
critique?
Just pick
like two issues, because
you may, first
you may end up talking for 10 minutes if you don't just pick two issues. So the issues that kind of emerged from the first 3 months of the Trump administration that you think are a big problem for Virginia and perhaps the country.
Well, let me start with health care, and then I'll get to criminal justice reform.
Okay.
In November of 2009, at 1:45 in the morning, our phone rang when I was asleep with my wife, Diana, 31 years. It was a doctor in an emergency room. He was so nervous, he was stuttering. And what he told us over that phone at 1:45 in the morning was that our daughter had what was later determined to be a lymphoma over her heart the size of a cantaloupe. The good news is this. Our 18-year-old daughter then went through 7 months of treatment and she's now cured. She's now 26. In 2013, I thought our medical travails were over. A doctor told me that I had at best a 50-50 chance to live. Lucky me, I was one out of a million. And what they did is they gave me a brand new blood supply to cure my rare blood disease and a stem cell transplant. Now, the Democratic Party's always looking for a candidate with new blood. And I submit to you, I have the newest blood of any candidate in American political history. Let's now focus on what happened a couple days ago. Healthcare is the moral challenge of our generation. Healthcare is a moral right. And what the Republicans did 2 days ago was absolutely disgraceful. The repeal and disgrace, the replace. It's personal to me, my daughter, and our family. And what they did was disgraceful, and what they did after was even more. They spiked the ball in the end zone, they had a party at the White House, and they acted like they were fraternity brothers. Well, it's not a joke. It's personal, because people will die if this replacement bill is put into effect. So I want to fight what they're doing, and also in Virginia, speak, give a voice, like I was as a prosecutor, for those 400,000 individuals in Virginia who are not covered by Medicaid. And it is going to be a great program, and Virginia and Richmond needs a fighter like me. The second issue I want to talk about is Jeff Sessions. Putting aside that he committed perjury before the Senate Judiciary Committee and should be indicted, in my view, he is going back to the 1980s, put more black people in jail, build more prisons. That is wrong, that is stupid, and it's costly. I have a strong criminal justice program where we don't build more prisons and we treat addiction like the disease it is, and we focus on rehabilitation. So those are two issues in 100 days where he, Mr. Trump, has gone the wrong way.
Yes, Patti, and I'm glad you limited us to two, because as you mentioned, we'd be here all day talking about the things that have gone wrong with this administration. It really has been a disastrous first 100 days, and it's also why, you know, in part, I fought so hard to elect Secretary Hillary Clinton. That's why I was a surrogate for the Clinton-Cain campaign and traveled, you know, thousands of miles around Virginia, because she would have been a far superior president to what we are seeing. Two specific issues, and I want to echo Jean on health care, because that really has been, I think, the biggest blunder in the first 100 days. It was a cruel, heartless bill that got passed. I think it was a moral travesty. And I'm hopeful that the United States Senate will fight back. We have Senator Tim Kaine, Senator Mark Warner, and others who have vowed to push back on this bill to make sure that it does not pass and cross the desk of the president, because it would, frankly, strip away health care from nearly 24 million Americans. Not to mention discriminate against people with pre-existing conditions, and women and young people and older Americans. So it really is heartless, it's cruel, it'll roil our healthcare industry, and I think harm our economy. It is the wrong thing to do economically. It's also the wrong thing to do morally. And so I think that has been a tremendous issue. The second one I wanted to quickly focus on was the Muslim travel ban and the immigration raids that we're seeing. I think it's been so mean-spirited, and I actually went out to Dulles Airport on the first night of that horrific, unconstitutional, immoral, absolutely. You saw me there. I was out there with dozens of other lawyers who were volunteering our services to help people who were unlawfully detained, and hundreds of protesters. And I say it's one of the proudest days I've ever had as an attorney, because every person who was unlawfully detained that night got to leave Dulles Airport to go home to be with their families, because we fought for them. We're going to continue to fight. We're going to continue to resist. But we have got to change the course of this country, and it starts right here in the Commonwealth of Virginia.
Okay, great. Thanks, Justin.
Thank you.
Susan.
Thank you, Patti. I think, I don't think you'll disagree with this statement.
We'll let Mike go last.
the biggest thing that Donald Trump has done in the first 100 days, his biggest accomplishment, is galvanizing millions of people, millions of Democrats, millions of people who did not participate in the election last year to fight against his discriminatory policies, his discriminatory, bigoted, unwanted policies. You know, the day after he was elected, I talked to a fellow, Graham Weinschenk, who's in Arlington, and he said before the election, people got along in high school, the kids got along in their different groups. The day after, he saw swastikas and all kinds of discriminatory and bad and evil things posted in the school. And all of a sudden, it was okay to call people's names, because the bully-in-chief made it okay. I think that's wrong, and that's not a country I was raised in, but I do think his biggest accomplishment was rallying all of us to fight these policies. And obviously, Trump care is just a disaster for all of us. In Virginia, we don't have expanded Medicaid for 400,000 people. Now, you add this on to that. I was in a drug treatment facility yesterday, and as you know, addiction we lost my stepdaughter. And they talked about the fact in the last 2 years they've been open, they have helped over 500 people. Right now, they have 250 enrolled. And now with Medicaid being able to come in to their facility, they see that rising dramatically by at least 50% over the next month or two. There's something wrong with that. When we're cutting services for women, I myself in college went to Planned Parenthood because they have life-saving screening tests. I think treating rape and sexual assault as a pre-existing condition is wrong. And I wonder what's next. Are we worried about what's going to happen to Medicare next? Because the path we're going down is not a good one. It's one we have to fight every day. And as an advocate for the last 30 years for the Commonwealth, I will continue with that.
Mike, you're getting blamed.
Congratulations.
Our president is getting blamed. I'll focus on health care since all three mentioned that, and then I'll talk about what I think are the good parts that came on. Yeah, there are going to be some changes, because I think we all know that Obamacare is a failure. It's falling apart. It's going to implode within the next 12 to 18 months. We just found out 2 days ago, was it, that Aetna is completely pulling out of the Virginia individual market now. There are going to be at least 25 counties, if not more, that are going to have zero choice in terms of what they can choose for their health coverage. And just having coverage doesn't necessarily mean you have health care, because the number of doctors who are accepting these plans is diminishing. The way they're unsuccessfully trying to keep costs down is by narrowing the networks, which means no, you can't keep your doctor, no, you can't keep your plan. Yes, it will cost you twice as much for less coverage, I'm one of those, you know, my name's Michael. I'm one of those people that had my plan ripped away from me and now pay three times more for less coverage.
For less coverage, yes.
My deductible is higher than it was. And I had a
Do you buy it yourself?
Yeah, I'm in the individual market. And, okay. and my, my I had one of those catastrophic plans. And it became more catastrophic because, and for three times the cost.
But the reason
because I'm no longer individually underwritten, now I have what's called community rating, and I'm thrown in there with everybody. So where they had a 30-year experience with me, they knew what my track record was, they knew what my trajectory was, and I could be charged on that. I can't, Obamacare took that away from me, and now I pay so much more for so much less. Anyway, where are we going? Well, as Susan knows, because she worked for the vice president, I assume y'all know, but it's a federal issue. What we saw last week is not what we're going to get. It's step one. It goes to the Senate. All the things that you're complaining about the loudest are all going to be stripped out because they don't make they don't meet the reconciliation rules. And then the Senate's going to work its will. Then it's going to go to a conference, and there that's where the bill really gets written in conference, and it has been written in conference for the past, you know, 100 years. And then it'll come back, and we'll see if it can pass both houses of Congress, and we'll see if it can get the president's signature. So I think we're getting a little bit too dramatic and a little bit excited about nothing.
I
would disagree.
Let me tell you something.
Feel free to chime in.
I am not getting excited about anything. It's a life and death decision for me.
But it's not, Gene.
Listen to me. You know? Listen to me, sir. It is not dramatic. It is life and death for me. I take medication right now.
Mm-hmm.
I took it today.
Right.
This bottle costs thousands of dollars.
Right.
And if I didn't have this bottle, I would be dead.
And
Listen to me, sir. Nothing about Obamacare gave you that bottle. There are individuals,
not a single thing.
There are individuals in the state of Virginia and throughout the United States that don't have insurance at all. And if they ever got the rare blood disease, let me finish, that I had, if they ever got a lymphoma over their heart the size of a cantaloupe that my daughter had, they would be dead if they didn't have insurance.
And
so it's not dramatic. It is a life and death decision to me, sir.
Let's stipulate it's not a complete failure. Let's stipulate that
it is
that
one of Barack
nothing,
Obama's greatest achievements, sir. And what bothers me most is the Republicans went up there a couple days ago, sir, and they voted on a bill without reading it and without getting a
sounds like Nancy Pelosi, doesn't it?
Without reading it and getting a CBO estimate. That is morally wrong after Mr. Ryan had said that he would do that. So I'm not dramatic. I am realistic, and I am talking about something.
Time out. I'm going to give you my two things
that are going right. Yeah. The first thing I'm going to stipulate, nothing about Obamacare provides you those meds.
He's not talking about himself.
Yes, he was. He talked about.
He's talking about what we're going to
have. What we're going to have.
I'm lucky.
What
I'm
we're
lucky.
Going to have with a bill that passes is not government control over health care, but competition, which drives down costs, which allows many more Americans to afford the health coverage that you want them to have. Now, as far as the two things that I think have gone right, really, really easy. I can't tell you how elated I am by each and every cabinet pick. Just the best lineup of cabinet personnel that I've ever seen.
Mike, that's outrageous. Let me finish.
Justin,
finish,
may I finish?
Thank you. Of course you may finish, but we may disagree as well.
So the cabinet picks, fabulous, led by the two generals, Mattis and Kelly, are just the two best people in the world to head those agencies.
So what about Flynn?
And then the third thing is, second thing that I think is absolutely perfect, and I can sum it up in two words, Justice Gorsuch.
Yeah. Well, Mike, there's so much to disagree with. First of all, again, going back to your statement that we all could agree that Obamacare is a failure, that's exactly wrong.
It is. It's going to
explode. No, Mike, can I finish?
In 12 months, Justin, it's going to be gone.
I guess you're the only one that gets to finish. Okay, I'd like to finish as well. I gave you the same courtesy. It's outrageous, and particularly for, you know, over 90% of Americans got health insurance once Obamacare went into effect. It did away with discrimination based on pre-existing conditions, which kept so many millions of people out of the insurance market and cost lives. Children who can stay on their parents' plans up until the
as
age of 26. What I'm saying is that didn't exist until Obamacare existed, and so to call it a complete failure, I think is a moral failure, and I think it's meant to get a rise out of people, but it's not meant to reflect the facts. when you talk about the cabinet picks and these being the perfect people, that's outrageous. You know how many people disagree with Betsy DeVos, Secretary of Education. Well, that's your opinion.
Fabulous.
That's your opinion, but you're wrong. Also, Jeff Sessions, Gene mentioned this earlier, who lied. Exactly. You must think it's fabulous to lie under oath, which I don't think is fabulous to lie under oath. Which is what Jeff Sessions did in his hearing.
He
did absolutely that. In addition to that, he was recused from the Russia investigation. And I'm proud of my senator, Mark Warner, who I helped to reelect as a co-chair of a statewide campaign, because he is the primary watchdog for this administration over Russia. So if you can say that these people are fabulous, that things have gone well, you sound in many ways just like Donald Trump. And Donald Trump has a 37% approval rating in the Commonwealth of Virginia.
Well, actually, Mike pointed out the three picks that were great. And the national security piece is pretty good. But the rest of the domestic cabinet, let's go to Susan.
Yeah, but wait,
for that.
We had Michael Flynn.
He said all of
let's,
them.
Let's
well,
talk about Michael no, Flynn
not
for
cabinet.
A second. He's not cabinet. Okay, well, I'm going to go back to
can
something.
Can I just say one?
I'll give you a second. I want to go back to something you said. You said that the bill that was passed in the House is going to get fixed in the Senate and compromise.
No, I didn't say it was going to be fixed. I said
it's going to be changed.
I said, yeah, dramatically.
Do you support all the provisions that the House Republicans put forward that would make most people from 50 to 65 before they go on Medicare almost ineligible because they have pre-existing conditions of the 50 or more that were listed? Do you support that?
You're bringing up something. I haven't even heard this argument before,
you
Susan,
haven't.
So
okay.
Come on.
Well, it started in the last day or two.
I think what I heard you say was that people over 50 are not going to be eligible to go on Medicare when they're 65.
No, that's not what I said.
That's what I'm saying. That's why you're confusing me.
No, in the bill that passed, people between 50 and 65, most of us at that point are going to have some kind of, whether it's vision loss, some sort of pre-existing condition that's listed.
Right. All covered in the Republican bill. All covered, mandated in the Republican bill.
You think that is?
All mandated. All right, absolutely.
I think we're going to have to pick apart the details of the health care bill. That does emerge.
But it's,
Susan,
it's mandated.
Let's let Susan, so we can kind of move off the health care, but let's talk it's about what
issue.
Else. What else are you concerned about with the Trump administration?
Well, there's two things. One, let's talk about the EPA, and let's talk about Betsy DeVos.
Okay.
I just finished a three-day tour, an anti-pipeline tour in Virginia, where Gene has joined me to be opposed to the pipeline.
I have as well.
At one point you said you didn't know, and then you said you were for.
I didn't say that at all.
Sorry.
I think our viewers should know that Governor McAuliffe has a contrary view. He thinks this pipeline is fabulous.
He can. Okay. So you're now opposed to the pipelines?
Susan, please don't misstate my position.
I'm
telling you my position, which I've said before, which is that I don't believe the case has been made for the pipeline, which is the same thing I've said through the outset. So,
got it. Well, Gene and I are opposed to the pipelines because we believe it's time to invest in renewable energy sources. It's dangerous. I was down in Nellie's Ford the other day where I was with about 100 people, and we were on the deck of a facility there, and they pointed to this bucolic farmland where cows were grazing. And one woman turned to me and she said, my house is right up on the top of that hill. You know what they're going to do? They're going to come top that roof right next to my house. And we're really afraid this is going to break. We're really afraid of the fracking, the results of fracking coming down the water. We're afraid. We all know that these pipes develop cracks. We all know they have a certain lifespan. And we're not focusing on renewable energy, which would be creating more jobs. We all know the jobs created potentially by these two pipelines coming in would be minimal at best, coming from out of state and not really hiring many of our people, and they're not long-term jobs. I think we need to focus on solar and renewable energies. I was down in the coal fields recently, and the coal miners turned to me and they said, you know, yes, some of us voted for Donald Trump because he gave us hope and he talked to us about the future. And they know that they're not going to have coal come back the way they hoped it would. And they sat there and said to me, we don't want dirty water either. But we want jobs and we want economic opportunity. And I turned to them and I said, well, what about if we took some wind turbines where those coal fields were and some solar manufacturing? They said, we're all for it. Bring it down. But then we go back to education. We have a Secretary of Education who does not believe in public education. We have almost 40% of the schools in Virginia right now that are 50 years or older, classified as historic. Donald McEachin, who I've joined with him and Mark Warner and Tim Kaine in an effort to pass a tax credit that would help us rejuvenate and rebuild these schools at a much lower rate. Donald Trump used this tax credit to build his Trump Hotel in Washington. Why can't we use it to build new schools?
All right, that's a good transition to our next question, mm-hmm. which is going to focus on the Virginia economy and ways that we can stimulate right. the economy. Gene, why don't we start with you?
All right, one of the biggest ways going, first off, Mike, you're taking a lot of incoming, so I pity you right now.
He was ready for it.
Hey, I was ready to go after you, okay?
He's used to John Flaherty.
I'm Italian.
I'll be disappointed if anybody takes it easy in the next 45 minutes.
I don't use my hands either.
Please don't. Please don't put the gloves on.
Yeah. Let me talk about the economy. One way to create 30,000 jobs is this. Expand Medicaid. If we gave those 400,000 individuals coverage and took the $8.4 billion that is just waiting in a drawer at the U.S. Department of Treasury and expanded Medicaid, we would create 30,000 jobs in a minute, maybe in a couple months, okay? That's
and
number
that's
one.
And that's not happening because it's not being passed by the legislature?
It's not happening because of the recalcitrant Republicans in Richmond. Second thing we need to do, if this Trump bill goes through from the House to the Senate, it is going to put a greater burden on working poor when it comes to health insurance. That's number one. And number two, if we do not raise the minimum wage to a livable wage of $15, how is a mother with two or three kids trying to work two or three jobs, trying to pay for this health insurance, how are they going to be able, how's that woman going to be able to pay for that? And the third thing I want to do is expand broadband to the rural parts of Virginia. 90% of Virginia is rural. And there are parts of Virginia that don't have internet. And if you're a small businessman, like I was for 15 years, I owned, managed, and operated a lumber business with 30 to 40 employees. I ran a factory. If you don't have some internet or technology, a business is not going to go there. Mm-hmm. Now, last thing I would do is small businesses. I just mentioned I was a small business owner. Democrats and Republicans will agree on this. Small businesses are the engine of any economy. Mm-hmm. And that's a business with 5 employees, 10 employees, 15 employees. And Republicans and Democrats can agree we can't smother those small businesses, mm-hmm. many of whom are run by women. We can't smother them with regulations. So those are at least 4 things I would do to give a jump start to this economy in Virginia. And by the way, it's doing pretty good. It can do better, but those are what I would do.
Great, thanks, Gene.
Yeah, and I would agree with much of that. Gene mentioned small businesses owned by women. One of those is my wife, Dr. Serena Fairfax. We, 10 years ago, bought a family dental practice, and it's been tremendously successful, and we need to make sure that more people have opportunity to own and grow their own small businesses. 97% of businesses in the Commonwealth of Virginia are small businesses, so we've got to make that available to more people. I agree with raising the minimum wage to a livable wage to $15, but also, and we have focused in on this, we need to get more people into higher paying what are called middle skill jobs. These are jobs that pay on average 3, 4, or 5 times the minimum wage, which we know is $14,000 for someone working full time at $7.25. By the way, we are $1.50 less than West Virginia in terms of our minimum wage. But these middle skill jobs, absolutely, these middle skill jobs are great jobs. Dental technicians, certified welders, long distance mm-hmm. truck drivers that people hire locally for, and people need the training and certification to fill them. Mm-hmm. That's the biggest challenge. The two biggest hurdles, people can't afford the classes and the certification, but they also cannot afford the opportunity cost of not working for the 9, 12, 18 months it takes to get certified. So we've got to create a bridge for more people to get access to those middle skill jobs. I was just in Roanoke a few days ago, and they said they have about 2 of those middle skill, higher paying jobs, $40,000, $50,000, $60,000 open for every one person available and trained to fill them. So that's where a lot of this opportunity exists. There are 175,000 of those jobs today in the Commonwealth of Virginia. We don't have to create them, we just have to fill them. We have 161,000 people who are unemployed in the Commonwealth of Virginia. So it really shows the opportunity. We also need to reduce the crushing burden of student loan debt on this generation. And you just talked about your great daughter at UVA. It really, and I think I'm the only person on the stage who actually has student loan debt. And I also, my wife and I have given money to provide scholarships to students to make their educations possible. I went to Duke University undergrad and Columbia for law school. And that
New
was
Devils.
Made possible, yes, because of other people. Great, it's a great school, we love it.
My wife I like the Tar well. Heels.
Yeah, well, we disagree on that wholeheartedly. So, but we have a plan to help people reduce that high interest student loan own debt, refinance it down at market rates. On average, the student debt load is $30,000 in the Commonwealth of Virginia for a recent graduate at an average interest rate of 8%. Which is dramatically high. So we want to get that down to market rates, closer to 2.5%, 3%. Yeah. The realtors are 100% behind this because they did a study which said for every $250 you reduce the monthly student loan burden on a young person, it equates to $40,000 in additional purchasing power for a home. Yeah. So this will impact our economy dramatically. And I, again, agree about broadband access and the rural parts of the state, really everywhere. We should be a wired state. That infrastructure investment is critical, just like our roads, just like Metro, which we've got to work to fix. So we focus on those things around economic security and opportunity, and we'll give more people a shot at the American dream, which really is the passion of my life.
Great. Awesome. Okay, Susan.
Well, I also
top I that. To, my God. You guys are like,
I wish
do something
like
different.
This.
I'll start with you next time.
But we talked about jobs, and we talked about clean energy jobs, and I think we need to focus on that. And as a former member of the Virginia Tourism Corporation Board, appointed by Tim Kaine, thank you very much, I think we need to do a lot more. You know, tourism in Virginia is a huge economic driver. And the Muslim ban at Dulles does affect people coming into this state and bringing their dollars. So I think we need to focus more on that. There was one time when I was on the board and we were down in the Northern Neck, and a fellow came in and threw down gold oyster shells on the table in front of us. And he said,
gold
painted oyster shells. Oh, and he said, okay. You know, we've let Maryland take the crab from us. Let's not let them take the oyster. So you know what's happened. We've now developed these oyster trails, lots of small businesses, lots of people working. And what else happened? The oysters clean the water. So I tell people, as Lieutenant Governor, I will make it, there's a couple of things we do as Lieutenant Governor, as you know. But one is it's a part-time job, and I will make it a full-time job. And I will travel to each locality and work collectively with them and to see how the Commonwealth can help them find their gold oyster shell. Because I know there are some communities already doing this on their own. Sometimes they need help, and they need a little bit of hand up, and I think we need to do that. The other thing that we need to do, obviously, is to make equal pay for equal work across the land. Women are lots of breadwinners across the country right now. Families depend on this, not just women. Men and women and children depend on equal pay for equal work. We need to work hard to do that as well.
And then at the state level, what can we do with the equal pay issue at the state level?
I think we need to obviously work on the minimum wage, mm-hmm. but we need to focus on some of these small businesses too. You know, I met a guy named Tommy Kellum, and he has a seafood business, and he's the fourth generation, and he wants to turn it over to his daughter. But he also said there are so many different regulations on top of regulations that are redundant. The feds do not as good a job as the Commonwealth does. Mm-hmm. I think one thing that we also need to do for small business to help them employ more people is to reevaluate some of our processes in the state. What needs done, what needs fixing, what needs changing. I think Governor McAuliffe has done a great job of bringing in new businesses to the state, but I think we could always do better, and we always need to be looking forward, not backward. That's why I talk about new clean energy and renewable jobs. I think we need to always be looking forward and not be afraid to evaluate programs that may not be working and change them if they need to streamline them a little bit better.
Okay. Mike, do you want to chime in on that?
I do. I'm glad to hear sort of across the board here a recognition that overregulation mm-hmm. does stifle economic expansion.
Yes.
That's not something I hear often from people in your party, so the fact that it's universal here is encouraging. It excites me, quite honestly, because when you regulate and tax something, you get less of it than when it's unregulated and untaxed. Now, we're talking about economic expansion. I'll just make two points. You can respond or not. The first is that one of the things that made the American economy great over 200 years, the best, the strongest in the world, is unlimited access to cheap and reliable energy. And when you use, as you have, Dominion Power as the whipping boy, which is the company that provides that reliable, unlimited energy to businesses and individuals within the Commonwealth of Virginia, I think you make a mistake, but I understand where your internal politics come from.
Or maybe they just care about the environment.
The second thing I would throw out for your consideration is, as I said, you know, when you regulate something or tax it, you get less of it. When you unregulate it and untax it, you get more of it. If we want economic expansion, we need a tax decrease in the Commonwealth. We haven't had tax reform in the Commonwealth for way, way too long. Everybody's talking about tax Commonwealth. I haven't had the chance to look at each of your proposals on that. If you have them, I'm sorry. I did have a chance to look at your governor candidates on that. And I note that one of your candidates thinks that what we need to finance all his wish for list is a dramatic increase in corporate taxes to pay for things such as free community college, free this, free that, free everything. And I wonder where you are on corporate taxes. If you tax corporate activity, economic activity, you get less of it. Do you buy into a tax decrease on corporations, or are you on his side with a tax increase
on corporations?
Let's let
Jean start on that. Actually, you know what? Let's let Susan start on this because she keeps being last.
Yeah. That's okay. Obviously, we have to look at all kinds of tax reform. As I just said, we have to keep moving forward. We can't get stuck in the past. And I think we have to look at making things easier for the hardest hit in the state. Obviously, we need to talk about that. I think we need to reevaluate some of our corporate taxes, particularly if they give a helping hand in areas of the state and start mentoring programs and start partnering with some of our localities mm-hmm. to help employ people in parts of the state that aren't doing as well as other parts of the state. So I do think we need to take a look at all this. I'm not prepared to say X number, X percent right now, but I think we need to work with corporations to help make everyone part of this growing economy in the state and not just certain parts of it, because there are so many left behind. I'm really honored to have the endorsement of John Boyd, the president of the National Black Farmers Association. And I know the farmers are having a hard time right now. I just came from Floyd, Virginia a couple weeks ago, and they were telling me about how people were leaving their area in droves, some of the younger folks, because there wasn't the opportunity. But they took it upon themselves to get together as a community and said, how can we make this area more economically sound to keep these some of our children here? And they came together and they bought a slaughterhouse. And they started working cooperatives where people could, farmers could bring their cows there, get them slaughtered there, which they get more money. And they get more money on each dollar if it's slaughtered than just in one piece. Sell it to the local Kroger, who can buy it for cheaper because there's not transportation costs, who then sell it to the local citizens who get their food cheaper and it's fresher. Mm-hmm. And so they're forming their own cooperative. And I think we have to work with companies and different localities and small businesses to how do we work together to include everybody. So they're bringing up their own area on their own. I think it's our responsibility, and I will take the lead in helping each locality do that in this Commonwealth.
Okay, great. Justin?
Yeah, happy to. I think first it's important to start with facts and not just theory. And the fact is that we have a great business climate here in the Commonwealth of Virginia.
We've fallen from number one in the country 5 years ago to not even in the top 10 today.
You know what else has fallen? You know what else has fallen dramatically? Our unemployment rate. We went from 5.4% unemployment 3 years ago to 3.8% today. More people are employed in the Commonwealth of Virginia. We have the lowest unemployment rate in the Southeast region. We've attracted now $14 billion of new capital under the leadership of Governor McAuliffe and the administration. We are bringing new businesses in, Nestle right here in Northern Virginia. I'm proud to have the endorsement of Congressman Jerry Connolly. We have a strong and thriving economy here in Northern Virginia and in other parts of the Commonwealth. We do have to focus on other areas. And I'm going to Southside Virginia actually later today. In Southwest this week. And so I've traveled 35,000 miles around Virginia in the last year. And we have support from so many people, hundreds of elected officials, party leaders, but also small business people. As I mentioned, my wife and I bought a family dental practice 10 years ago. We were just out of graduate school, me out of law school and my wife out of the VCU School of Dentistry, where, by the way, she was named the most outstanding dental school alumna of the last decade.
You're proud of her.
I'm very proud of her. She's extraordinary. She's a Virginia native, a great person. But even when we graduated from graduate school, we each had six figures of student loan debt apiece. Mm-hmm. And yet we still were able to purchase, a small business, access capital, and that was because interest rates were at historic lows at 2% and 3%. We bought a home in the same year. And it's that kind of economic opportunity that we want for everyone. So we can't just go with these slogans and bumper stickers. They don't govern very well. What governs well is smart policy. I'm a public policy major out of Duke. I'm on the board of the public policy school. I'm somebody who likes to dig into the numbers and the facts and the figures and not go around sloganeering all day because it doesn't really work. We saw in Virginia the no car tax pledge, and that was a good bumper sticker, but it was a bad policy. And we're seeing this now, again, all around the country. Folks want thoughtful people who are not just going to scream at each other, not just going to accuse each other of things, and not just slap bumper stickers and everything. They want people who are going to be thoughtful, going to help grow our economy, create more opportunity for everyone. And again, I'll conclude with this, that not only is the theme of our campaign, economic security and opportunity, but it's the passion and the story of my own life. I was raised in inner city D.C. in the mid-1980s, primarily by my mom. I have a great dad. But we had to move in with my late maternal grandparents because my parents divorced, life happens, and my mom needed a place to start over with her four children. I was the youngest of those four. Because we got opportunity, a high quality education, faith, hope, spiritual wealth is what I call it, my mom was able to buy the home across the street from my grandparents, and she was able to send all four of her children to college and two of us to law school. That's the American dream that we want for absolutely everybody, and a bumper sticker won't get that, but hard work, thoughtful policy will.
Gene?
I am the proud grandson of four Italian immigrants. All came
that
from
makes there. You a purebred.
I'm not a mutt.
And I'm Irish, so.
All Irish?
Pretty much.
Okay.
That's my spaghetti sauce against yours.
My mother has the best spaghetti sauce. Proud grandson of four Italian immigrants. They either came into New York or through Ellis Island. And I'm also the proud son of Joe and Alma Rossi. And they nicknamed my father after. They called him Ted after Teddy Roosevelt. Who was my dad? He was had a great eighth grade education. He was an orphan when he was 15. And when he was 21, he picked himself up and he started a lumber business with 30 to 40 employees. Tragically, my hero died very suddenly when I was 10 years old. Very suddenly. And my single mom, who had nobody, she had to raise four unruly Rossi boys. I was the youngest, I was the most unruly, and I went off the track a little bit, and I devoted more time to the basketball court and the lumber yard. I was All-State, 1,300 points, than to the
library. I saw that on your website.
I'm very proud of that.
I like that.
Then to the library and the books. I almost flunked out of high school. And now I teach trial advocacy at Harvard Law School. Do I believe in the American dream? Do I believe in the impossible dream? Absolutely. Let me talk about small businesses. I owned a small business after my father died. I ran a small business. I had to see the ups and downs of 30 to 40 employees. I knew their families. I cried with them. I went to their funerals. Small business is in my blood. Let's go to your question. Should we tax businesses? Yes. But should we overtax them? No, but we should be fair in how we apply a tax. And going back to this healthcare bill, which is an outrage, it's giving tax breaks to people that don't deserve them. Do I believe the corporations should be taxed to the moon? Of course not. But I don't think the top 1% should get a tax break and the bottom 1% have to scrounge to pay for health care and to support your two kids. Now let's talk about budget deficits, because Republicans never talk about it. I'm very proud about my wife. She's one of the greatest people I've ever met. 31 years we've been married, we have three great kids, send them to public schools, T.C. Williams High School, and Alexandria. She had the honor and privilege for being chief of staff to the greatest Secretary of Education this country ever had, Richard Riley. And please, sir, please, with the utmost respect, Mike, please don't say that Betsy DeVos is a great secretary. Compared to Mr. Riley, Secretary Riley, it's not even close. But let's go back to Bill Clinton. You know what he did in the 1990s? He was one of the best pro-business presidents we will ever have. Why? He raised taxes on the ones who don't deserve a cut, and he balanced the budget. We had surpluses in the late 1990s. And what that does is we're not crowding out private capital. When the federal government is going into the private sector to crowd out capital, because one third of our budget is to pay off interest on the debt, we are stifling business, small business. Gilmore, Justin brought up a good point.
If we could. That's a long answer, and I like it.
Let's
give him a little bit more, and then we're going to move on to a couple specific issues.
Didn't answer the question, by the way. I want to answer your question. What we did was we balanced the budget like Mark Warner did after he had to take over for Governor Gilbert. So going back to your question, which we should be answering, do I think corporations should be taxed? Yes, but fairly. Just like I don't think individuals should be overtaxed, but they should be taxed fairly.
Okay, I give Gene credit for addressing the corporate tax, which was essentially my question.
Exactly.
But you didn't say if fairly is exactly where they are now, higher taxes the way Tom Perriello wants, or lower taxes the way Gillespie wants.
I gotta read his proposal.
So, you know, are we talking, in general, what do you think? Do corporations pay? Will we get more economic activity and more job creation and a stronger economy in Virginia if we cut corporate taxes?
Not necessarily. And again, it's got to be about the holistic policy and the budgeting. Does everybody even know what the corporate tax rate is in Virginia? What is the corporate tax rate in Virginia?
I don't.
It's 6%. Mm-hmm. So we're talking about something that no one even knows.
But yet,
No. Again, this is why facts matter. This is why facts matter. This is why thoughtful policy matters. Because if we just talk in slogans and we talk theoretically, then we never get to a solution. We have got to dig down, drill down, and really provide concrete and specific answers. And Gene, look, you gave a good answer, but you mentioned balancing the budget after Gilmore. Of course, in the Commonwealth of Virginia, it's constitutionally required that we balance the budget. So every governor and every general assembly has to balance the budget.
Gilmore used the smoke and mirrors.
It is constitutionally required to balance the budget.
He used smoke and mirrors.
Every governor, every general assembly balances the budget because it's required. Because it's required by the Constitution.
But
so
he
again,
did leave a deficit for Mark.
He left a deficit.
No. Listen, what I'm saying, based on projected revenues, and Mark Warner is an extraordinary governor. He's a great senator. But again, we have got to get to a place where we're talking about thoughtful public policy specifics and facts. Otherwise, we're going to talk around each other all day long.
So in terms of generating more capital and increasing opportunities for people to start their own small businesses like you did, do you have specific proposals on that?
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, Justin, could you answer his question?
Yeah.
It's
related.
I answered his question when we started. He said,
no,
if you reduce, he
said,
if
you,
he said,
not
if you,
necessarily.
I said, not necessarily.
Oh, okay.
Do you remember that?
Okay.
Yes. All right. Let me go to Patty's question.
You're a small business owner. You used to be a small business owner. You understand small business, you know, blah, blah, blah. Okay.
Yeah.
Let's take the most onerous, ridiculous, in my perspective, business tax we have in the Commonwealth of Virginia, and that's the BPOL.
I agree.
Does that need to be absolutely outlawed in the Commonwealth of Virginia?
Well, that's one we should absolutely look at, and my wife's dental practice is subject to the BPOL tax, and this is one that we have paid.
Can you explain the BPOL?
This is business professional occupational license tax.
Yes, absolutely.
And so that's one I think we should look at. Again, you talked about the corporate tax rate, which could
be... I'm bringing BPOL in secondarily now.
I get it.
Since I wasn't getting an answer on my
question. That is what I should look at. I gave you an answer. Again, I told you it was 6%, and I'd have said not necessarily you'd get growth. Again, you know what's the best thing for small businesses to grow and to thrive? Is demand. We need people who have money in their pockets who can actually pay for the services that small businesses provide. My wife's dental practice... Would it be great to get 0.25% off the corporate tax rate? I'm sure that would benefit at some level, but you know what would be better is 100 more people who could afford to get dental services.
Yeah.
100 more folks who can get a bridge and a crown and really provide those services. It provides more revenue to the small business. It provides more jobs to the employees. And so we've got to be about stimulating demand. And Patty, you asked about how do you get more access to capital? Again, a few specific things. One I already talked about, reducing student loan debt so that more people can actually access capital. And when we reduce that student loan debt, more folks can go out and borrow and have a credit profile that allows them to start a small business and to grow one. Also, we need to partner with community banks in particular. We have relationships with
a number of small banks.
I think this should be a public-private sector opportunity because there are pilot programs that we have seen around the country where they have helped people, particularly in underserved communities, access capital where they otherwise might not be able to get traditional bank financing. So these are things that we can do.
So you're talking about the government guaranteeing the loans?
Well, listen, they do that. It depends on the program.
But I'm asking actually, you, but you what your proposal is.
It depends on the program, Mike. It depends on what the goal is. With government guarantees loans in a lot of contexts, in mortgage contexts and
others.
I think we need to keep looking forward and looking for new ways to make money. New businesses coming into the Commonwealth, not just the same old, same old.
And I've worked
for some companies that had trouble. I worked for Altria, and I helped them change the way they do business by helping to implement the Master Settlement Agreement and pass FDA oversight tobacco, because there are 100,000 people in this Commonwealth that have jobs, their incomes depend on that. And these are good paying jobs, a lot of these jobs. So why I bring that up is that was a company that realized they needed to change the way they do business to keep going. I believe Dominion, Appalachia Power, and the others need to look at how they do business to move forward in the future to make sure that more people are working, we have better jobs and better opportunities. You know, we're teaching kids now 21st century jobs in 20th century schools. Somehow that doesn't make a whole lot of sense. We're not creating more innovative products. We're not working towards the future. We're going backwards. If you're not going forward, you are going backwards.
Right,
and I think we have to invest in more of that.
We've just got about 6 minutes left, okay. And I wanted to give each one of you about 2 minutes to tell us, you know, number one, why you're running and how you distinguish yourself, or however you want to wrap it
Do
up.
Do you want me to go first, Susan?
I'll let you go first, Gene.
Okay.
We haven't talked in a little while.
All right, should I look into the camera? Not that I don't want to
look. Which way should he look?
Not that I don't want to look at you and mom.
Look to your left, Gene.
Right, this camera here. Look at that.
Right here, okay.
Help you out.
It's the wide shot. It's the wide shot.
It's right here.
Okay. No, Inger said that way. Yeah, that way.
Oh, there
you
go.
We got it.
I'll get it right. Thank you for having me this morning. Once again, I'm Gene Rossi, and I'm very honored to be here with Justin, Susan, and our great moderators. And I feel a little sorry for Mike because he took a lot of
income. He's used to it.
But goes back to what I said. I am a lifelong Democrat, born and raised, and I have a passion for protecting people, and I'm a fighter. And my fight and my passion came from what I did for the last 27 years, fighting in 110 trials, two of them with Justin, and speaking for those who couldn't speak for themselves. Victims alive and dead, the ignored, the afraid, the forgotten. And I want to tell you a little bit about me again. I'm the proud grandson of Italian immigrants and the proud son of Joe Rossi and Alma Rossi, who made mean spaghetti sauce, by the way. And we had a great family, and my dad died when I was 10, and he left us a small business, and that business had 30 to 40 employees. And I was the youngest of four Rossi boys. I almost flunked out of high school, and I now teach at Harvard Law School Trial Advocacy and Constitutional Law at George Mason University. Do I believe in the American dream, the impossible dream? Yes. What do I want to focus on? Healthcare, education, small business, and criminal justice reform. Healthcare, it's the moral outrage of the day. Public education, strong public schools. Criminal justice reform, addiction is a disease, and mass incarceration is not the cure. And I lived and breathed small businesses, and I want to make this Virginia economy the strongest economy in the United States.
Right, thanks,
I ask
Gene.
For your vote, GeneRossi.com.
All right, thank you, Dean.
Yes,
well, just want to make sure we have time for
everyone.
Sure,
absolutely. Thank you all. It's been a pleasure to be here with you and honored to get to be on the show. Again, my name is Justin Fairfax. I'm candidate for Lieutenant Governor of Virginia. I'd be honored to earn the vote and the support of your viewers on June the 13th. We have a Democratic primary. And as I mentioned earlier, I've traveled around the state, 35,000 miles around the Commonwealth of Virginia in the last year. We got into this race May of 2016 and fought over the last 4 years in particular for Democrats, for progressive causes to help elect some great leaders. Again, Senator Mark Warner, I was co-chair of his campaign in 2014 and a surrogate for the Clinton Cain campaign in 2016. And have fought at the state and the local level to make sure that we preserve our progressive values. I'm proud of my work, my career. I'm proud of my family. We've gotten to travel and live the American dream. And again, we want that for everyone. We want everyone to have a shot at economic security and opportunity to reduce the crushing burden of student loan debt, to get access to capital to start and grow a small business, to get higher paying middle skill jobs so they can change the economic trajectory for their families, to reform our criminal justice system. Virginia is number one in the school to prison pipeline, and we want to do away with that school to prison pipeline and make a school to workforce pipeline. We also want to protect our environment, give people opportunity, and I would be honored to earn your vote again on June the 13th. Fairfax4LG.com is our website. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Justin. And Susan?
Thank you, Patti. Well, I'm Susan Platt, and I'm also running for Lieutenant Governor, as you know, and I'm so honored to be here today. And I look up to the heavens because I wish my pops were here. He was one of 13 children from an immigrant family who made it. He made it through the college and the GI Bill. He got to live his dream to become a mechanical engineer. And he raised me when my mom passed away at 9, and he raised me to do whatever I could in life, that I would not be held back by gender or by anything else. And so I'm here to tell everyone in the Commonwealth that I want to do the same thing for you. You know, my husband and I have been married 37 years. We've had a pretty good life, and we've had some knocks. My stepdaughter died a year and a half ago due to addiction, which was a long process. And we were there for my grandchildren like my pops was there for me when my mom passed. But I will tell you, my granddaughter once said to me a couple years ago when she heard me on the phone with my husband talking about the need to change the tires on my car. And she said, Grandma Susu, as a feminist, you should be changing your own tires. And I said to her, it's because I'm a feminist, I have a choice, and I choose not to do that. And I'm here today to help everyone have the choices and make their own choices in life and not be defined by who they are, who they love, their sex, where they're from, or their religion. And I think it's time we do that. I've been proud to help so many women across the Commonwealth run for office. We've elected quite a few. I've trained over 300 myself. And I want to make sure that we have someone who looks out for children and become the children's advocate in the governor's cabinet. So I thank you today. I will leave you with one more thing, which is we've had 40 lieutenant governors in Virginia's history, 6 Johns, 4 Jameses, 2 Roberts, and 1 L. Douglas. And I hope you'll help me become the first Susan. It's Susan Platt for VA.com, and I ask for your vote and support. Thank you very
much. Thanks, Susan.
Patti, if I may, just remind our viewers that June 13th is the primary for everyone, not only these three very impressive candidates for Lieutenant Governor in the Democratic primary, but there's a Democratic governor's race, as well as a Republican governor's race, and 3 people in the Republican lieutenant governor's race.
Great. Thank you so much for that, Mike. It's great to have this great group
here.
Thank
you, Mike. Thanks so much. Patti, thank you very much.
Good to see you.
Thank you.
Nice to meet you, Gene.
It's a pleasure.
Thank you.